the left of me and jokers to the right, I tweet smug in the knowledge that I've just pointed out that politics in this day and age is just too polarised. The far right of the frankly uncivil Tory party led by the odious Boris Johnson, whereas the far left have rabid Marxist Brexiteer and communist Czech spy Jeremy Corbyn. That is an actual news story that ran. Where's the reasonable middle ground, I cry? Where are the reasonable evidence-based policies of politics past? When we could, as a country, come together around the magnificent achievement that was the London 2012 Olympics.
Right Honourable George Osborne MP, Chancellor of the Exchequer, who is accompanied by Mr Chris Branridge.
First boos that we've heard all week at the Paralympic UK. Stadium.
This is a frankly spot-on impression of the sort of discourse I see every day in my Twitter self-flagellation exercises. Beginning with the ascendancy of Jeremy Corbyn and fermenting since the Brexit referendum, privileged figures, largely from the press and media, for whom politics had been largely a game of debates and jokes, profess shock and horror as they find themselves suddenly affected by politics. No more could they insulate themselves while a resurgent popular left-wing movement was building. No longer could they pretend politics was just a game when their side was losing. This video explores how the privileged calls for middle ground politics are nothing more than a thinly veiled appeal to maintaining the status quo. There's nothing sensible, reasonable, or moderate about keeping things as they are. So let's start talking about this political centre ground nonsense. This discourse implies that these categories of left, right and centre are relatively stable and constant features, which is obviously not the case.
I would argue that the centre ground has distinct values and principles of its own to do with responsibility, yes, to do with fair play, but also evidence-led policy making, not ideology and populism, which has definitely been on the march in recent years. And that's where I think the real dividing line is now between responsible politics and populism.
Evidence-led policy making, not ideology.
Oh yeah, Chris, that makes sense. We should have politics without ideology. We should have politics without ideology. Jesus Christ. These folk, man. Let's just cut to Corbyn. He explains it okay.
That the political centre of gravity isn't fixed or unmovable. Nor is it where the establishment pundits like to think it is, because they know everything, as you know. It shifts as people's expectations and experiences changed, and political space is opened up. Today's centre ground is certainly not where it was 20 or 30 years ago.
Indeed, in the UK there's been a massive realignment over the past 40 years about what constitutes left and right and centre since the emergence of neoliberalism. And this isn't something new, realignments happen all the time. For example, the anti-union legislation brought in by Margaret Thatcher was accepted by New Labour under Tony Blair, meant that these anti-union laws were no longer a right-wing phenomenon, but part of the natural state of politics.
Forget the past. No more bosses versus workers. We are on the same side, the same team.
The left moved significantly, and the centre moved right with it. Another good example can be seen with tax rates. During World War II, the highest tax rate was 99.25%, and in the 50s and 60s, under Tory governments as well, it was around 90%. It's now 45% in the UK, and the idea of increasing it to 90% is seen as left madness. And, like, there was an outcry when Ed Miliband in 2015 suggested raising it to 50%. Red Ed, with his Marxist dad, as it was called, the idea of a 50% top rate of tax was seen as outright socialism. So the political centre ground is at best a vaguely defined and ever-changing concept that doesn't tell you about the validity of political ideas, but at very best tells you about the scope between what different groups might offer. what positions might be considered valid as well. No one is calling the Labour Party the centre-ground party, but their form of social democracy, with some socialist spice just thrown in there, is maybe considered a midpoint between socialism and free market capitalism. But within our current framework, there's no large-scale organised movement promoting socialist revolution. Instead, capital holds the power, and the slight deviation from capital's line is considered extreme. The Labour Party is considered a far-left party because of their slight deviation from capital's whims. We won't really get very far analysing what the centre ground is as a measurable phenomenon, I don't think. But and what I'm really interested in is the value assigned to the category of centre or moderate. It isn't really a firm political centre ground that centrists are chasing, but a specific ideological position. An easy way to view this problem in action is by looking at it through the lens of the British political landscape. So first let's establish the broad positions of the three main national level parties. For simplicity's sake, I'm not going to talk about the SNP because their ragbag, mixed bag ideology would take a while to unpack. On the right, we've got the Tory Party, who've been in power in one form or another since 2010, and who've been responsible for decades worth of austerity, which was described by the UN Special Rapporteur on extreme poverty as tantamount to a human rights disaster. The effects of this include 14 million people living in poverty in the UK and a projected increase of child poverty to 40% by 2022 should trends continue. The Tories have also overseen the implementation of what's come to be called the hostile environment towards immigrants, which includes notorious go-home vans being sent round communities, and the Windrush scandal. The scandal, which began under Theresa May's tenure as Home Secretary, involved the detainment, denial of rights, and wrongful deportation of black people who were born British subjects, mostly from the Caribbean, and brought to Britain often as infants during the 1970s. Many of these people had spent their entire lives in Britain, but were being threatened with deportation because of the government's racist, hostile environment. And while this is by no means a complete picture of the depths of Tory depravity, you can get an idea of the sort of extreme politics they represent. Importantly though, what's driven the centrists most forcefully from the Tories isn't austerity or the hostile environment, which represent the natural continuations of the neoliberal policies of Thatcher and Blair. What has panicked the centrist is Brexit. The fear of change, the fear of politics affecting them beyond their column pages and dinner parties. For the moderate, the far right is Brexit, not the sustained class warfare. On the other side of the supposed loony fringe of our current UK political discourse, we have the ascendancy of veteran left-wing Labour backbencher Jeremy Corbyn to the leadership of the party. This was done on the back of a massive member-led movement. For the past few decades before Corbyn's ascendancy, the Labour Party had capitulated to the neoliberal ideology pushed by Thatcher's Tory party. It accepted that neoliberalism was the correct way to structure our political and economic systems. Now, however, Corbyn's emerged to throw out the new Labour neoliberal era. Try saying that a few times when you're drunk. New Labour, neoliberal era. New Labour, neoliberal era. At the time I'm recording this, the 2019 Labour manifesto is not yet out, but Labour have committed to an anti-austerity agenda, a repeal of anti-union legislation from the 1980s, and an overhaul of our punitive welfare system. This is the hard-left, loony fringe Labour Party decried by centrists. This social democracy, which is good, but still not enough, is what's driven the Liberal commentariat and much of the New Labour holdovers within the party so incandescent. It's a challenge to their ingrained neoliberal view, and they just can't take it. In their minds, this is socialist revolution. But the one similarity, and there is only one, really, between Boris Johnson and Corbyn's Labour that the moderates can't abide, is that they're both offering some form of change. Obviously, there's no moral equivalence between the Tory vision of change, which is essentially the continued consolidation of power in fewer and fewer hands, and the Labour vision, which is an attempt to do precisely the opposite. But the moderate knows what they like, and they liked the 2012 Olympics. This was before Brexit, and despite it being 2 years into the harsh programme of Tory-led austerity, it still held up as a moment of mythical societal unity. Sure, there were problems, but these problems were solvable within a familiar framework, and they didn't affect the moderate. So what party is offering no change? What party is not on the linny fringes? Well, for the moderate, the answer is, of course, the Liberal Democrats. Since the 2016 Brexit referendum, the Lib Dems have sought to stale themselves as a moderate anti-Brexit party. But between 2010 and 2015, they were the junior coalition partners in a government with the Tories. Along with the Tories, Lib Dems implemented that same austerity agenda, that same class warfare. Now, much of the Lib Dem defence of this is that they were a moderating influence on the Tories. One famous and delicious example of this can be seen in this wonderful Twitter thread. I'm just going to keep it on the screen for longer than you probably need to read it, because it's really quite delicious. This is the moderate force in British politics. The reasonable middle ground were happy to go into coalition with the Tories and enact savage welfare reform that's still harming the worst off in society in return for 5p charge on plastic bags. We do have to remember that the legacy of the Tory party that I quoted earlier is also the legacy of the Lib Dems. And indeed, the new Lib Dem leader, Joe Swinson, voted for the austerity programme and was the minister responsible for actions such as increasing employment tribunal fees to £1,200, a serious barrier to anyone who wants to attempt to fight back against their exploitative employer. And they had other things too, like breaking their pledge on tuition fees and raising them to £9,000 in England. The Lib Dems are Pontius Pilate. They're trying to wash their hands clean, and they're using Brexit to do it. Since the referendum, the Lib Dems have been styling themselves as the party of Remain. They campaigned on a second referendum with no other real policy platform, and they frame this in the liberal language of appeals to rules and sanity. But they would say, we know Vote Leave broke the law, so the referendum is therefore illegitimate. We have to hold it again. And people didn't know what they were voting for, and they do now. They've smothered their continuity politics in the language of democracy. They've appealed to the moderate against the extremists by never really laying out any political vision beyond stopping Brexit, stopping change. But since the Labour Party have changed policy to back a second referendum, the Lib Dems have been in a bit of a bind. With no real policy agenda, they've had to try and outdo Labour's Brexit policy in a vain attempt to remain relevant. This meant that they briefly shed their democratic illusions and argued that should they win a parliamentary majority, should they win a parliamentary majority, then they would immediately revoke Article 50, and which would put a stop to the Brexit process entirely. Unfortunately for them, this didn't play very well. Now they're back to supporting their second referendum position. But this really shows just how central Brexit is for the Lib Dems' rehabilitation strategy. If they can't be the one party to oppose change, then they have nothing left to offer. So when centrists talk about the moderate centre ground between the extreme left and the extreme right, they aren't really talking about any truly definable centre. Again, all the moderate middle ground has come to mean is an appeal to the status quo. The problem is, for millions of people, not only is keeping things the same unbearable, but things have been actively getting worse for a long time.
What made you contact the food bank at that time of night?
I'd sat and thought about it for about a week or something. And you've got pride, you know what I mean? You don't want to have to ask for help. I have nothing. literally nothing, couldn't get help from nowhere, rang the door, nothing, wouldn't give you advance payment, not their problem, go to the council, kind of the council have got now, there's just no help. No, if you lose your job and you go on universal credits, you're knackered.
In 2018, the Joseph Rowntree Foundation published a report which found the number of children living in poverty had increased by 500,000 since 2011-12. This had brought up to 4.1 million children living in poverty in the UK. In-work poverty has also increased dramatically, and while the employment rate has increased, it's not delivered lower poverty rates. Since 2005, the poverty rate has risen faster than employment, which shows the claim that the best way out of poverty is work is just nonsense these days. It's not. For a lot of people, poverty is just a function of work. And this is just a small snapshot of what the poorest in our society have to deal with. For them, the moderate appeal to continuity is unacceptable. Things can't keep getting worse at the same rate as they are. I mean, try and tell someone who was affected by the Windrush scandal that we just need to get back to a pre-Brexit era, when things were okay for people. Things weren't okay for people. They've never been okay for people. Another reason that this maintenance of the status quo isn't just unacceptable but unsustainable is that the maintenance of the neoliberal status quo shares significant blame for the emergence of the new far right and for the victory for Leave in the Brexit referendum. I've got a couple of videos that go into that in greater detail, so I won't go into it hugely now, but I will say that the politics of the middle ground are unsustainable. By sticking to a broken status quo, the politics of the moderate has dug its own grave. The conditions are stark, and the solution will not be moderate. But these stakes are higher still, as we know the planet is burning, and we need to take extreme action to stop this. If we don't drastically change our approach to the environment, then the consequences will be dire. And for millions around the world, the consequences of industrialised capitalism are already dire. Droughts, floods, famines, displacements, all affecting some of the poorest people across the world. And there's no room for moderate action. Currently, the Labour Party is committed to achieving net zero carbon by 2030. Included in this is the nationalisation of energy companies. This is essential for removing the profit motive and market logic of energy companies. Such logic prevents any definitive action. There will be no chance that oil production will become unprofitable before the climate catastrophe tips over the edge. The market motivation has to be removed from energy companies. The moderate position offered by the Lib Dems, by contrast, is to increase renewable production of energy to 60% by 2030 with no nationalisation of energy companies. This moderate position would be wholly inadequate for getting even close to dealing with the climate disaster that's already begun. In reality, this position isn't moderate at all. How could measures that don't even get close to saving the planet due to a mix of no ambition and being ideologically married to neoliberal market solutions ever be considered moderate? Sorry, planet. I know the loony left had some more extreme ways to try and save you, but us reasonable, evidence-based moderates decided that we couldn't let politics become too socialist-y, so we decided to let you burn instead. This was the only moderate thing to do in the end. The idea of a political centre ground is a myth, and there's no fixed meaning to left, right or centre. These ideas are fairly nebulous. So if a political centre ground isn't really an ideology, what is it that the centrists want? I think what the centrists or moderates really want is nothing. They want no change. Things can only not get better. The Lib Dems have capitalised on that by picking the most obvious moment of political change in our recent time and staunchly opposing it. The problem is that our society, our planet is sick and we need change. The moderate will keep the poor destitute and the rich powerful. The moderate will see the planet burn to protect the system. The moderate will always find themselves siding with the right, who want to keep the system, over the left, who want to destroy it. Recently I had a conversation with former New Labour and now Lib Dem voters about why they would vote Lib Dem. They had no idea what policies that the Liberals were offering them beyond being anti-Brexit, but they knew that they hated what Labour stood for. Socialism and change. The phrase politically homeless was used with deep anguish, which, you know, is something I find a little bit cathartic, since until the election of Corbyn, there was no party even close to offering me the politics that I wanted. But as with most politics, it was a position motivated by pure feeling. They knew their life was good, and they'd be loath to change it, even slightly. But the world's changing, and it's always changing. All we can do is try and push it in the right direction. There's nothing moderate about the status quo. If you've made it to the end, thanks for watching. I have noticed that my analytics have people dropping off pretty early in these videos, which feels great. So if you made it to the end, hey, cheers. Do all the things. Share it, like it, leave a comment. Subscribe if you want to see more of me ranting about politics. And get out and campaign for change. There's an election coming up and we need it. Cheers. Good times are changing and I will be pulling for no times to hold the door. Stop or change. We can't capitulate as history repeats.